today is common elective orthopedic procedures and the clinical and the clinical effectiveness umbrella review of level 1 evidence. This study was done by Ashley W. Bloom and colleagues at National Institute of Health Research, Bristol, Biomedical Research Center, University Hospital, Bristol, and Western NHS Foundation Trust and the University of Bristol, UK. It was published in British Medical Journal 2021 in the month of June. This study was basically done because the burden of musculoskeletal condition on health services is large. More than 1 million patients usually present to the orthopedic department of the various hospitals in various countries, which accounts for a large amount of burden on the health services, especially in the center where like the national health services exist and the payment is done by the government for the expenditure. They have got their own recommendations, but these recommendations have not been supported by randomized controlled trials. They have been there in the practices, but nobody has done any kind of a research to see how effective those recommendations are. So according to WHO, the most common and disabling musculoskeletal condition are osteoarthritis, back and neck pain, fractures associated with fragility of the bone, injuries, and the systemic inflammatory conditions such as rheumatoid arthritis. Musculoskeletal conditions are typically characterized by persistent pain and restricted mobility. According to a study done in 2017, the global burden of disease of the musculoskeletal conditions were the biggest contributor to the global disability. However, many musculoskeletal conditions can be managed on an outpatient basis on the basis of interventions such as exercise, weight management, physical therapies, even psychological therapies help, and drug treatment. There are only few patients who do not respond to these conservative measures who have to undergo further specialist care or surgical care or both. In United Kingdom, musculoskeletal conditions account for more than 25% of all surgical interventions in the National Health Services, which in itself accounts for a large burden on the NHS. Total joint replacement is one of the most common elective orthopedic procedures performed worldwide for end-stage osteoarthritis. Although total joint replacement is considered to be clinically effective intervention for the management of osteoarthritis, it also accounts for enormous expenditure in the health system. And even after the total joint displacement, the entire mobility of the joint is not there. Some patient, approximately 6% of the patient, they complain of some or the other kind of a pain, an explanation of which is not available to the clinician. The term clinical effectiveness is about ensuring that healthcare practice is based on the best available data and evidence of effectiveness. National Institute of Health and Care Excellence, NICE, defines the clinical effectiveness of a treatment as how beneficial the treatment is under usual or everyday condition compared with doing nothing or opting for another type of care. Concerns have been expressed that many orthopedic surgical interventions as well as prostheses used in these interventions do not have readily available high quality evidence on their clinical effectiveness to support their use. So these are all the basis why this study was done, because there were guidelines available, but nobody cared to see how effective those guidelines are. A recent review found that 24% of all hip replacement implants available to the surgeons in the UK did not have evidence for the clinical effectiveness. So basically, it's because the implants which is being put into the patients, they are not of that quality which can replace entirely the function of a joint. Although clinical guidelines defined as systematically developed statements to assist practitioners and patient decisions about appropriate health care for specific clinical circumstances, aim to be performed by the best available evidence, they have often been criticized for the lack of methodological rigor and applicability. A critical appraisal of existing treatment guidelines for the management of hip and knee osteoarthritis by the Osteoarthritis Research Society International Treatment Guidelines Committee observed that the overall quality of the existing guidelines was suboptimal and consensus recommendations were not always supported by the best available clinical evidence. In this context, using an umbrella review of systematic reviews or meta-analysis of the randomized controlled trials or other study designs in the absence of meta-analysis or randomized controlled trial, it was aimed to evaluate the clinical effectiveness of 10 most common elective orthopedic procedures, assess whether the evidence based on these 10 orthopedic procedures had effective guidelines, and identify the gaps in the existing evidence. So basically, the researchers in this study, they went to different hospitals. They took out the data. They had a look at what was the elective orthopedic procedures which was being done commonly. They had a talk with the surgeons which were performing those procedures, and on the basis of that, they chose 10 most common orthopedic procedure which was done. These are the database which they analyzed. This umbrella review was conducted according to preferred reporting items for systematic reviews and meta-analysis, PRISMA, and MOOSE, which is meta-analysis of observational studies in epidemiology guidelines, and was based on a predefined protocol registered in the Prospero International Prospective Register of Systematic Reviews. So to identify the 10 most elective common orthopedic procedure and their indication, the authors combined a literature search of relevant articles on the topic, an assessment of hospital episode statistics, procedure frequency count, and discussions with prominent and experienced orthopedic surgeons. They used these three approaches in parallel and compared the results. As the results were generally concordant, no further selection or arbitration procedure was needed. So these are the 10 most commonly performed procedures which was done in the hospitals in UK. Most of them are commonly, which is the arthroscopic procedure. Then there is and the lumbar tunnel decompression. Among all these procedures, there was some evidence such as that lumbar tunnel decompression had some benefit to the patient, and knee replacement had some benefit to the patient. But still, despite that having the benefit, these are all operating procedures, and they are all associated with some kind of complications later on. So the data source was Medline, Embase, Cochrane Library, from the inception to the September 2020, for studies that compared the clinical effectiveness of each of the selected orthopedic intervention with no treatment, placebo, or non-operative care was searched. Separate search was done for all the procedures. The computer-based searches combined free and mesh search terms, keywords related to the orthopedic procedure and population. Filters were applied for systematic and meta-analysis. The authors restricted the search to articles written in English language. So for the study selection, they had three authors. Two authors evaluated. So for this study, they had three authors. Two of the authors had an independent review of all the studies which were there. If they had any dispute, they had another third author, which acted as a arbitrator, that which study should be taken up. So the eligibility criteria. Studies were eligible if there were systematic reviews, meta-analysis, including randomized controlled trials that compared the clinical effectiveness of any orthopedic procedure mentioned above with no treatment, placebo, or non-operative care. In the absence of meta-analysis or randomized controlled trials, the authors sought individual randomized controlled trials followed by systematic reviews, meta-analysis of observational cohort studies in that order, according to the hierarchy of the evidence. Whichever was a higher level evidence, they selected that. The authors excluded network meta-analysis, narrative reviews, systematic reviews that did not pool data or did a meta-analysis, and meeting abstracts. For multiple Cochrane reviews evaluation the same topic, the authors selected the most recently updated one. Data extraction quality and the risk of bias assessment. One author initially extracted data by using a standardized data collection form. The second author independently checked the extracted data against the original articles. In the event of discrepancies between authors, a third author was consulted. The authors explored whether the studies evaluated possible sources of heterogeneity across studies by using methods such as subgroup analysis, and whether the authors formally conducted a sensitivity analysis. They assessed the methodological quality of each included meta-analysis by using assessment of multiple systematic reviews AMSTAR instrument. It is an 11-item tool that is widely recognized for assessing the methodological quality of systematic reviews meta-analysis and has got good reliability and external validity. The tool included ranging of ratings for quality of the research. The maximum score was 11. The authors considered the random effective model to be the most appropriate pooling approach given the heterogeneity in the study design and population in orthopedic research. The author used a JADED decision algorithm. This is the JADED decision algorithm, which presented the same question. If the answer was yes, they found out if it was the same trial, whether it was the same quality or not, and on the basis of that, if there is data extraction, heterogeneity, data synthesis, and they selected that study. So So this procedure was applied to all the studies. These questionnaires were put to all the studies, whether the study was answering all these questions or not. So the authors used the JADE decision algorithm to provide recommendations for the use of each orthopedic procedure. Given the conflicts among systematic reviews or meta-analysis that produced difficulties for decision makers in making recommendations on a particular intervention, the JADE decision algorithm was developed to help decision makers to select among discordant reviews. It has been and is now widely used for developed treatment recommendations for among meta-analysis with discordant result. Finally, following the collection of the evidence, the authors compared findings of each procedure with national guidelines to check whether recommendations for each procedure reflected the body of available evidence. In this, there is a group which is known as Patient Experience Partnership in Research Group, which is available at the hospital in Bristol. So that group was involved to see how much effective is the treatment and the guidelines which have been given to the patient to decide that treatment. So in the Musculoskeletal Research Unit of the University of Bristol and North Bristol NHS Trust, they have a dedicated patient and public involvement group, the Patient Experience Partnership in Research. This comprises patients, all of whom have undergone core treatment for various musculoskeletal conditions. It is a facilitated group that works in partnership with researchers to provide patient and public input into research and helps to identify avenues for dissemination of research findings. The authors' regular meeting with the group inspired this review. So these are like 10 orthopedic procedures which the authors selected. They found for ACL reconstruction 120 studies. Out of these 120 studies which were screened, 116 were excluded on the basis of title or abstract. 4 were full text article which were assessed, and 1 was full text article which was excluded. So finally, they had 3 citations included in the umbrella review. Similarly, for all these, they had the questionnaire, they reviewed the studies. So for arthroscopic meniscal repair, they had 1 citation included. For arthroscopic partial meniscectomy, they had 6 citations included in this umbrella review. For arthroscopic rotator cuff repair, they had 3 citations included in the umbrella review. For arthroscopic subacromial decompression, they had 3 citations included in the umbrella review. For carpal tunnel decompression, they had 9 citations included in the umbrella review. For lumbar spine decompression, they had 12. For lumbar spine fusion, they had 13. For total knee replacement, there was 1 citation, and for total hip replacement, there were 3 citations. This is the final outcome of the studies, and on the basis of this table, we can say how effective each procedure is. Here we have got the various pain score and functional scores for different kind of a procedure. The color in the yellow, which is the mostly in the chart, shows that there was no difference whether the patient was operated or whether the patient has a conservative management. Green favors procedure, which as you can see has got like very few places over here, and white is like not reported like whatever the patient had done. Now we'll have a look at each of the 10 procedures individually to see how we came to the conclusion and how effective was it and what was the failure rate and the problem the patient faced. For arthroscopic anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction for ACL ligament deficiency, of the 120 citations retrieved for ACL ligament reconstruction, 3 articles were eligible for the review. Public dates ranged from 2014 to 2020, and AMSTAR score, which has got the highest score of 11, was 9 to 11. 2 reviews included a mix of comparative observational cohort studies and 1 randomized controlled trials, which compared surgical treatment with non-surgical treatment. The third was a Cochrane review, which evaluated 1 randomized controlled trial. All 3 reviews in the pooled analysis showed no difference in patient-reported outcome measures, and the grade quality of evidence was low. A total of 2 randomized controlled trials were included in this review, and each reported no difference in patient-reported outcome measures between surgical treatment and non-surgical treatment. For arthroscopic meniscal repair of knee for traumatic tears, 26 articles were reviewed. There were no reviews of randomized controlled trials comparing arthroscopic meniscal repair with no treatment, placebo or non-operative care. However, the authors identified a review of mostly observational studies, including 1 RCT, that compared meniscal repair, open suturing and arthroscopic inside out procedures with meniscectomy. In this review, meniscal repairs were reported to have better long term patient reported outcome measures, better activity level and lower failure rates than meniscectomy. In the single randomized controlled trial that compared a variety of surgical procedures like arthroscopic repair, arthroscopic minimal resection and repair, or arthroscopic partial meniscectomy with non-surgical treatment, clinical findings based on International Lean Documentation Committee protocol suggested that non-surgical treatment was unsatisfactory. Arthroscopic partial meniscectomy of knee for degenerative tears. So for traumatic, they said that the surgery is favorable, but for degenerative, we'll see how they say. Of the 82 retrieved articles on arthroscopic partial meniscectomy, 6 were eligible for evaluation. It has an AMSTAR score of 8 to 11. In all the 6 reviews of RCT, randomized controlled trials, arthroscopic partial meniscectomy did not show clinical important benefit over conservative treatment of knee function and pain. So for trauma, we can go, but for the degenerative, it's got no evidence. In the most recent review, which was based on 10 randomized controlled trials, arthroscopic partial meniscectomy did not provide a clinical meaningful improvement in the knee pain function or quality of life. However, small benefits of arthroscopic partial meniscectomy were reported for patients without osteoarthritis. The authors indicated that surgical treatment should not be considered the first-line intervention for patients with knee pain and meniscal tear. Arthroscopic rotator cuff repair for acute rotator cuff tear. They had 117 articles reviewed, out of which 3 articles were eligible for this meta-analysis. The AMSTAR score was 7 to 11. One study compared arthroscopic versus mini open rotator cuff repair and reported no difference in surgery time, functional outcome score, visual analog pain score, and range of motion between the two techniques. In a Cochrane review that mainly compared arthroscopic rotator cuff repair with or without subacromion decompression versus non-operative treatment, exercises like or with or without glucocorticoid injection, as well as other comparisons, like arthroscopic rotator cuff repair provided little or no clinical important benefit for pain, function, quality of life, or participant-related global assessment of treatment success compared with non-operative treatment. In the third review, which compared surgical repair versus conservative treatment or subacromion decompression alone for degenerative rotator cuff tears, surgical repair resulted in significantly improved outcomes compared with other strategy. So there was only one study which said that the surgical approach is better. However, the rest of them said that the conservative method is better. Given that the 3 reviews did not investigate the same research question, the authors selected the review with the question closest to us on the basis of the Jared decision algorithm. The best available was the Cochrane review 28, which showed no clinical important benefits of arthroscopic rotator cuff repair over non-operative care. Arthroscopic subacromial decompression for subacromial impingement syndrome. The authors reviewed 81 articles and 3 fulfilled the eligibility criteria. All the studies were recent. They were published in 2019 and 2020, had an AMSTAR score of 9 to 11. All 3 reviews compared subacromial decompression surgery for subacromial impingement syndrome or subacromial pain syndrome or rotator cuff disease with any other treatment like placebo, size therapy, physiotherapy, or no intervention. All 3 reviews indicated that subacromial decompression did not provide clinically important improvement in pain, function, or quality of life as compared with other treatment, which are placebo, exercise therapy, physiotherapy, or no intervention. Carpal tunnel decompression for carpal tunnel syndrome. There were 50 retrieved citations. 9 were eligible for this study. This had a wide range of date for the studies, like 2008 to 2019. AMSTAR score was 7 to 11. 8 of the reviews compared endoscopic or limited incision with open or standard incision carpal tunnel decompression for treatment of carpal tunnel syndrome. Only 1 meta-analysis compared surgical versus non-surgical treatment. In the single meta-analysis that synthesizes 4 randomized controlled trials comparing surgical versus non-surgical treatment, which included like splinting or local corticosteroid injection, surgical treatment was shown to relieve symptoms significantly better than non-surgical treatment. However, surgical treatment was associated with more complications. No randomized controlled trial compared carpal tunnel decompression with placebo or no treatment. So we have got to have more studies on this carpal tunnel syndrome decompression to come to a final conclusion whether the surgery was better or the conservative therapy is better. Here we have got like a 50-50 evidence. Some say surgery is better, some say conservative is better. However, if you look at the complications, we'll go for conservative treatment to be better. Lumbar spine decompression for spinal canal stenosis. Of the 137 retrieved citations for lumbar spine decompression, 12 meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials were eligible for the review. Publication dates 2011 to 2020, AMSTAR score range from 6 to 11. Three meta-analysis compared surgical procedures like decompression, spinal fusion, interspinous process device implantation and laminectomy versus non-surgical treatment like orthosis, rehabilitation, physical therapy, exercise, heat and cold therapy, TENS application, ultrasound, ultrasonography, analgesic, NSAIDs, epidural steroids, cognitive behavior therapy. And nine meta-analysis compared two or more surgical or decompression procedures like decompression, spinal fusion, decompression plus fusion, interspinous process device implantation, discectomy, laminectomy, and laminotomy. The three meta-analysis comparing surgical treatment with non-surgical treatment showed similar effects of operative and non-operative intervention. For the comparisons among different surgical procedures, the results were generally consistent. No difference was seen in outcomes such as pain intensity, physical function or disability status, quality of life, recovery, perioperative blood loss, operation time, length of stay in the hospital, reoperation rates when the techniques were compared with other. So in this study, they say that the conservative therapy as well as the surgical therapy has got an equal outcome. So it's better to go for conservative because with the surgery, we have got so many complications. And if the patient is having the same relief with the conservative, so it's better to go for the conservative one. Lumbar spine fusion for degenerative diseases. 13 meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials were eligible for the review. The date of publication ranged from 2010 to 2020. AMSTAR score was 6 to 11. Nine meta-analysis compared lumbar spine fusion with total disc replacement. Two compared lumbar spine fusion with non-operative management, which again included physical therapy, patient education, exercise, pain relief by acupuncture and injections, and two compared minimally invasive with open transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion for single level degenerative disease. The two meta-analysis compared lumbar spine fusion with non-operative management. Both reported no difference in Austria Disability Index score. However, one review reported that lumbar spine fusion was associated with surgical complications. With the publication of newer randomized controlled trials, recent reviews show that total disc replacement significantly improved pain and patient satisfaction, reduced reoperation rate and operation time, shortened duration of hospital admission, and decreased post-surgical complication compared with lumbar spine fusion in both the short term and the long term. The findings of the two reviews comparing minimally invasive versus open transforaminal lumbar interbody fusion for single level degenerative disease were discordant, except for less blood loss and longer fluoroscopy time with minimally invasive procedure. The best available evidence showed that the minimally invasive procedure was associated with less blood loss, shorter hospital stay, and slightly less disability. No randomized controlled trials have compared lumbar spine fusion with no treatment, placebo, or sham surgery. We selected two randomized controlled trials to represent the best body of evidence for lumbar spine fusion. Both trials compared lumbar spine fusion with cognitive intervention and exercises and showed no difference in success rates and return to work. So this study also come to the conclusion that the conservative as well as the surgical has got no difference in the outcome. So it's better to go for the conservative therapy because with the surgery, they have got a lot of complication. There's blood loss. However, with the newer techniques of endoscopic surgery, the blood loss is however less, but it's not available in all the places. Total hip replacement for end-stage arthritis. Of the 168 retrieved articles, no review of randomized controlled trials comparing total hip replacement with no treatment, placebo, or sham surgery for the treatment of end-stage arthritis was identified. We found no individual randomized controlled trials comparing total hip replacement versus non-surgical treatment. Three systematic reviews evaluated the clinical effectiveness of total hip replacement versus resurfacing arthroplasty for the treatment of end-stage arthritis of the hip. The AMSTAR score was quite low. It was from 4 to 6. The evidence on functional outcome, failure rate, mortality was inconclusive. The risk of revision and component losing were higher, but the risk of implant dislocation was lower in patients receiving resurfacing arthroplasty compared with total hip replacement. We also identified three individual randomized controlled trials that compared the effectiveness of resurfacing arthroplasty with that of the total hip replacement. Except for a higher risk of infection among the patients who had total hip replacement, evidence on all the outcomes was inconclusive. So for even for the total hip replacement, the author says that though surgery is being favored, it results in more infection, and they have got evidence for that, but they don't have any evidence available for the effectiveness of the outcome. So basically for this also, they recommend that it's better to have a conservative treatment as long as possible. Total knee replacement for end stage also arthritis. Of the 344 retrieved articles, no reviews of randomized controlled trials comparing knee replacement versus no treatment, placebo or sham surgeries for the treatment of end stage osteoarthritis was identified. They found one randomized controlled trial published in 2015, which compared total knee replacement followed by non-surgical treatment versus non-surgical treatment alone. So here also the treating doctors, they went for conservative treatment first. When the conservative treatment failed, then they went for the surgery. So the non-surgical treatment were like exercises, education, dietary advice, use of insoles and analgesics. In patients with moderate to severe knee osteoarthritis who were eligible for unilateral total knee replacement, findings showed that the treatment with total knee replacement followed by non-surgical treatment resulted in greater pain relief and functional improvement after 12 months compared with non-surgical treatment alone. However, total knee replacement was associated with a high number of serious adverse effects. So here also the recommendation is like, first we have to go for the conservative treatment as long as it's possible. Once the patient disability is reached to such a level that the conservative treatment is not working, then we can think of the total knee replacement. However, before that, we should always go for the conservative management of the knee osteoarthritis as well. So in this, the authors sought to examine the body of evidence on clinical effectiveness of 10 of the most elective common orthopedic procedure and assess the impact on the guideline recommendation. Of the 10 procedures, no randomized controlled trials have compared total hip replacement and meniscal repair for acute tears with non-operative care. The other 8 procedures which have been studied in such trials and some evidence support the superiority of total knee replacement and strongly supports carpal tunnel decompression over non-operative care. So out of the 10, only 2 diseases which have got some evidence to support that the surgery is better as compared to the conservative management. However, even those two, like total knee replacement and carpal tunnel decompression, the associated surgical complications and the disability is more. So it is like recommended to go for the conservative first before we go for the surgery. Randomized controlled trials have shown that arthroscopic anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction, arthroscopic partial meniscectomy, arthroscopic repair for acute rotator cuff tear, arthroscopic subacromial decompression, lumbar spine decompression for spinal canal stenosis, and spinal fusion for degenerative disease have similar outcomes over with the non-operative one. Comparison of the study's findings with the current recommendations and guidelines of the national bodies is interesting. The guidelines, they favor surgery. However, this study, which was done, which is a level one study, they recommend conservative is better. So the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons recommend using arthroscopic anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction in certain subgroups of the patient, as well as using either rotator cuff repair or non-operative care for rotator cuff tear. In the 2018 arthroscopic meniscal surgery treatment guideline for the British Association of Surgery of the Knee, it recommends using arthroscopic meniscal repair to treat meniscal lesions of the knee in some patients, while acknowledging that no high quality level one evidence is available to support this. So even though the recommendation says that the surgery is to be done, they themselves acknowledge that there is no high quality evidence to support their recommendation for the surgery. The NICE guideline recommendation is to use lumbar spine decompression when non-operative treatments has failed. NICE and other guideline bodies, on the basis of observational data, recommend total hip replacement for end-stage osteoarthritis of the hip. Encouragingly, many of the guidelines from prominent national bodies closely reflect the current body of evidence. So the recommendation is there that we should go for the conservative treatment. However, in practice, even the surgeons who are following those recommendations, they advocate the use of the surgery. But the guideline is with this outcome of the study. Consensus statements from the guideline societies do not recommend arthroscopic partial meniscectomy in patients with knee pain and a meniscal tear. Strongly recommended against the use of subacromion decompression surgery for subacromion impingement syndrome. Support using open or endoscopic decompression for carpal tunnel syndrome. recommend against lumbar spine decompression for people with low back pain, and recommend total knee replacement only for end stage osteoarthritis of the knee. The evidence base for recommendation on total knee replacement was built wholly on observational retrospective studies that have often used prosthesis survival as the main primary outcome measure. So even with the total knee replacement where they recommend the surgery, they have the study which was done, it was done on the survival of the prosthesis, not on the basis of the functional outcome or the functional benefit to the patient. Although seven of the procedures have been recommended for use by national guidelines, a high quality body of evidence on the clinical effectiveness to definitely support this recommendation does not exist for most of these recommendations. This is mainly a consequence of the lack of randomized controlled trials that compared the procedure with non-operative care. The evidence base for the recommendation was mostly built on comparisons involving two or more different techniques of the same procedure, like for example, endoscopic versus open, observational retrospective studies and case series with no control groups and expert opinions. For example, the recommendation for arthroscopic meniscal repair were based on mostly indirect evidence and low quality observational studies. And the guideline group highlighted this as a priority area for further research. For total hip replacement, the evidence for the recommendation was based on head-to-head comparison between different types of hip prostheses and uncontrolled studies that have used prosthesis survival as primary outcome measure. So basically, they are comparing which type of prosthesis is better, not which procedure gives a better outcome to the patient. This lack of randomized controlled trial evidence does not mean that the interventions are ineffective, but without evidence for randomized controlled trials, disentangling regression to the mean, surgical placebo, and the true treatment effect is extremely difficult. The strength and the limitations of the study. The strength of this study include its novelty and the comprehensive research of well-known databases as well as guidelines. Although umbrella reviews provide top-level evidence and important insight on the clinical effectiveness of intervention, several inherent limitations to our reviews deserve consideration. Because of the absence of meta-analysis on a few procedures, due to the lack of RCT trials, we use relevant studies designed according to the hierarchy of evidence. We use UK NICE guideline evidence research for recommendations on each procedure, given that the study setting was UK. The recommendations can be applied to other healthcare settings. However, as our research yielded guidelines from elsewhere in Europe and the US, so they had compared the US guidelines as well and included that in the study as well. Finally, several of the meta-analysis included in our review scored low when appraised with the Amstrad tool, showing the need for further review to use accepted method of reporting. When high quality evidence showed that a non-operative care is equivalent, surgeons and patients should carefully consider what would be achieved by doing surgery. A cogent argument can be made for surgery being used as a second line treatment when non-surgical measures have failed, or in certain subgroups of patients who have been identified as responders to surgical treatment. For an operation such as total hip replacement, the understandable assumption is made that all improvement is due to the surgery, but some may be due to the natural history, including regression to the mean or treatment effect from non-replacement co-interventions. Given the current waitlist for surgery due to COVID-19 pandemic, a randomized controlled trial comparing total hip replacement with best non-surgical care can be timely. Some of these interventions are just not clinically effective or may be effective only when used in specific circumstances. For example, although the use of arthroscopic partial meniscectomy in patients with knee pain and a meniscal tear is not recommended, especially in patients with significant or end-stage osteoarthritis, guidelines suggest that the procedures can be used for a specific type of meniscal tear and should be used only in patients who have not responded to a period of non-surgical treatment. Despite the good body of evidence on the clinical ineffectiveness of arthroscopic subacromion decompression, national clinical guidelines recommend its use for patients with pure subacromion shoulder impingement whose symptoms fail to resolve with adequate non-operative treatment. The observation that most commonly used and recommended orthopedic procedures had a limited and low quality evidence base relating to the effectiveness is concerning. With these findings, a need exists for an improved and more rigorous approach to the recommendation of the procedures with limited evidence on their clinical effectiveness. On the basis of clinical evidence from various guidelines included from NICE, 17 interventions have been selected and have been categorized as those that should not be routinely commissioned or performed and those that should be routinely commissioned or performed only when specific criteria are met. An urgent need exists to prioritize research, especially for the procedures with a limited clinical evidence, and for definitive randomized controlled trials designed to evaluate their clinical effectiveness. This will improve patient care, cut healthcare costs, permit more effective use of our resources, and increase societal trust in the orthopedic interventions. A recent comment in the BMJ suggested that we should use impactful evidence-based surgery alongside impactful evidence-based non-surgical care that may be faster, safer, and delivered at a lower cost. So this umbrella review of the body of evidence on the 10 most common elective procedures. So this umbrella review of the body of evidence on the 10 most common elective orthopedic procedures suggests that most of these procedures recommended by the national guidelines and used by surgeons have insufficient readily available high quality evidence on their clinical effectiveness, which is mainly because of lack of definitive trials. This forces patients and clinicians to make decisions based solely on observational evidence. When randomized controlled trials have been conducted, they sometimes support observational evidence and expert opinion, but not universally so. To optimize decision making, surgeons should apprise themselves of the evidence, make decisions based on the highest quality trials available, and in the absence of these, based on the judgment of observational evidence, acknowledging that this may be imperfect. Simultaneously, surgeons and research funding bodies should actively contribute to the filling the key knowledge gaps by enabling and participating in well-constructed pragmatic randomized controlled trials. So basically, this study suggests that it's not always wise to go for surgical intervention because that creates a lot of burden on the healthcare system when majority of the diseases can be managed in the primary care with conservative treatment like physiotherapy, TENS, intralesional steroid injection. However, most of these patients are being operated upon with an evidence which does not support the surgery as compared to the conservative management.